Hey everyone, Omar is here. Today it's about modern hardware and one of the most successful operating systems ever released by Microsoft. We're talking of course about Windows 7, which was launched back in 2009 and quickly gained a massive following, being installed on more than half of all Windows PCs in just under 3 years, something that the latest Windows wasn't able to pull off despite trying so hard. Support for Windows 7 was somehow officially ended in January 14, 2020. However, its update servers are still operational and are expected to stay alive until October 2025. But there is a problem. If we are installing Windows 7 from an original disk, like I'm about to do, we won't be able to grab any updates right away. Instead, we'll get stuck in an endless checking for updates loop. So, to reconnect with the Windows 7 update servers, we need to install manually a few critical updates first. But before we get into that, let's take a moment to review our hardware setup. We are using the same Intel i5-14600KF plus the Z790 motherboard combo from my previous videos featuring Windows XP and Vista. This time though, we're adding something new, a thermal right contact frame. This is an anti-bending piece of metal that is supposed to improve cooling efficiency. I am pretty sure that the standard bracket is designed to withstand a lot of bending force, so I'm not expecting a dramatic difference as advertised, but it's not that complicated to install it, so why not give it a try. Next, I'm using the Akasa AK620WH, which is a massive double fan cooler. Normally, I'm not a fan of oversized coolers, but with a 14th gen CPU, it makes perfect sense to go with heavy duty equipment. Now, while I'm still fiddling around with this configuration in the background, let's go back to the topic of the day, installing Windows 7 on modern hardware. The easiest way to install Windows 7 on modern hardware is to avoid dealing with USB 3X during the installation, as the Windows 7 installer doesn't natively support it. Don't worry, USB 3X drivers can be easily added later after the setup is complete. But if the only way to install it is by having USB 3 support in the first place, we have to take our time and create a custom installation ISO with the latest drivers. It's worth noting that the original USB 3 drivers released by Intel for Windows 7 are not working with the latest chipsets, like this Z790. I know it sounds funny, but actually the latest AMD USB 3X drivers released for Windows 7 are working perfectly fine on our setup, and these exact AMD drivers will be used later to get USB 3 support. As for today, I'm taking the easy way out for this installation and I will stick with the original Windows 7 installation disk. And since this motherboard includes a PS2 port, USB isn't required to complete the installation. But to make things easier, I added a PCIe to USB 2 card so I can plug my mouse during the setup. This USB 2 controller has a VIA 6212 chipset, which is automatically detected by Windows 7 installer. And the same will happen with our SATA drives. Native SATA slash AACI support has been available since Windows Vista, and when it comes to installing Windows 7, it's still possible to do it on very modern hardware without any workarounds or patches as long as we use SATA drives. So it doesn't matter whether we are using a 14th gen CPU or a Pentium 4, as long as the motherboard is running with CSM enabled. While Windows 7 does support UEFI, it's not an option for the setup since it's a multi-boot PC running operating systems like Windows 98 or XP. And that's why I'm using as a primary video card an Nvidia 7900GS GPU, which is a beast for Windows 98, and as a bonus, it will be promptly detected by Windows 7, so we can get into full HD right during the setup. It's worth noting that we can install up to Nvidia RTX 300 series GPUs in Windows 7 while using official drivers, which is of course a big deal for an operating system released back in 2009. However, before we can install any RTX driver, it's mandatory to have Service Pack 1 installed along with a few other critical updates. One of the most important updates is KB4490628, which is mostly about SHA-2 support. Without this update, Windows 7 won't recognize the digital signatures of newer drivers, making them unusable. Not only that, but since 2019, all Windows updates have been signed with SHA-2, making dispatch essential for any further system updates. In addition to what we'll call the hash update, we also need the Windows update fix and the convenience rollup update, unofficially referred to as Windows 7 Service Pack 2. Well, this big 500 megabytes update pack proves to be indeed very convenient for this exact configuration. For starters, WinSat is now functional, so we can assess system performance, though we won't get a perfect score yet since we are still running with a 2006 Nvidia 7900GS GPU. The onboard sound codec is finally detected, which is surprising since it was readily available in Vista from the very beginning. Also, the Realtek Ethernet card is now enabled, so we can start downloading all the remaining updates. But before we do that, even if we don't plan to use it, installing Internet Explorer 11 is a necessary step as it will update some essential system files. Once these five updates are installed, we can finally download all the remaining updates directly from the official Windows 7 servers. And just like in the good old days, several restarts will be necessary to finish the process. The good news is that we will get some newer system and security updates released after Microsoft officially ended support in January 2020. But when it comes to drivers, hardware support ended even earlier, so we won't get any new drivers through Windows Update. Now let's talk about USB 3 support, or rather the lack of native USB 3 support, which is a thing for Windows XP, Vista, and 7. This limitation can be frustrating, but with some fiddling around, it's possible to enable generic USB 3 functionality on all these three operating systems. For Windows 7 specifically, I came across some unofficial drivers that are supposed to work with both Intel and Ryzen latest chipsets and are reportedly based on AMD's USB 3X drivers. While I haven't checked these drivers in detail, the X470 chipset released by AMD in 2018 was the last to offer official Windows 7 support, so it makes sense to use the last official drivers for a new generic driver. And now back to our installation. Everything went fine, no issues, and this is all it takes to have USB 3 support in Windows 7. So now it was time to use my Kingston USB 3.2 external SSD to make some tests. This drive can reach transfer speeds up to 1000 megabytes per second, so we can easily go beyond USB 3.0 transfer speeds. And as you can see, everything is looking good. I somehow overlooked testing the onboard NVMe functionality. Anyway, on this exact configuration, NVMe drives are working perfectly fine on both Windows XP and Windows Vista. Given this, there shouldn't be any compatibility issues, especially since Windows 7 has official NVMe support, but must be added through an update. At least we don't have to look for unofficial drivers. This also applies to the RTX 200 and 300 series, both of which were released during a time when Windows 7 still held about 20-25% market share, so Nvidia just couldn't say no to Windows 7. Everything worked smoothly with the driver installation, just a quick restart and we are good to go. For some testing, I picked Ridge Racer, a racing game from 2012, released during the peak of Windows 7's popularity. It's so refreshing to see it running on much more powerful hardware. Not that it won't run on the latest Windows 11. Actually, Windows 7 games generally run perfectly fine on later Windows editions, except for those that rely on save disk or some Securom technologies, but these issues primarily affect games released during the Windows XP and Vista eras. Such games won't run on Windows 10 or newer because, as someone from Microsoft explained, this DRM stuff is also deeply embedded in your system, and that's where Windows 10 says, sorry, we cannot allow that because that would be a possible loophole for computer viruses. So if you still have a big collection of games on CD, DVD, keep in mind that Windows 7 is the last version that will let them run as originally intended. On Windows 10 or newer, we'll need to find the DRM-free version or take in consideration a no-CD workaround. Now back to RTX cards on Windows 7. The 300 series cards are still being produced, which means it's entirely possible to buy a brand new PC with a cheaper RTX card and install Windows 7 on it. All this while getting a decent driver support for an OS released back in 2009. Of course, this would be something like a Plan B in a multi-boot setup, perfect for a more authentic retro gaming session. Now, in the end, I realized that a game with RTX support might have been more interesting to see it in action in Windows 7. But all my RTX games are tied to my Steam account, and speaking of Steam, as of January 2024, Windows 7 is no longer officially supported. Though there are some workarounds to keep it running, but that's a topic for another time. I think this is it for today. Thanks for watching, and stay tuned as we are coming back to Windows 98 in my next video. On real hardware, of course.